Thank you for the invitation. I have some points I would like to argue. These are the points that CCS is getting increasingly important. And that's actually a change since we wrote the book. The second is that I disagree with Miriam a bit. I think CCS has been way too slow. And the development since the book has been not much to brag about, in my view. And I think one of the important reasons for CCS not getting along, not being accepted, and so on, is the way CCS originally was framed. In the beginning, it was seen, there are other reasons, of course. There are costs, there are the energy penalty, and all other kinds of risks. But the way it was framed, it was in direct competition with a renewable energy future, because it was basically connected to thermal power plants. And the success in that area has been rather meager, I would say. There are not many places where you have actual carbon capture and storage projects. There are about 18 of them. There's some in under development and so on, but CCS for now captures about 37 million tons of CO2 a year, which is not that much. Okay, this is the 1.5 degree special report from the IPCC. This is what makes CCS really important. Not only CCS, but also BECCS, bioenergy, carbon capture and storage. And this is four illustrative scenarios from the IPCC report. The P1 to the left has no CCS, no BECCS. It only has afforestation as the way to reduce emissions. This is what, when I speak to the climate scientists, this is the only realistic option for the future. Okay, and then if you go to politics, you move to P3 or P4 as the most realistic options for COP to reaching the 1.5 target. Okay, these one have some implications. First, these scenarios, if we are to reach 1.5, we will have to reduce half emissions by 2030. We have to be net zero in 2050. So the 1.5 report had two important messages. One, the risks are getting increasingly bigger. You can reach tipping points and so on that you don't know what will happen with afterwards. And also that the impact and difference between 2 degrees and 1.5 are huge. The impacts are much worse in a 2 degree scenario than a 1.5. This has had an impact not only on politicians and discussions within politics in the European Union, in Norway and other places, but it could be one of the reasons that Greta Thunberg argues that, or says that, I want you to panic. Okay, so Extinction Rebellion and so on, I think, have been fueled by this report. Okay, so what does these, if we move to the right, that's scenarios where we overshoot. So before 2050, we burn more fossil fuels than we should, and then we have to remove it from the atmosphere. Okay, so if we go to some of the scenarios that captures between 5 and 10 gigatons, draws 5 to 10 gigatons out of the atmosphere, this requires about 3 to 6 new CCS or BECCS facilities being built every week from now till 2050. There's currently one BECCS facility in Illinois that removes about 1 million tons of CO2. And we need much more than that. So the question is, do you think that this is a likely development? Can we rely on carbon capture and storage and BECCS in order to reach these targets? I don't think so, and I think we need much more and other policies in addition. Okay, this is the book, that's the commercial. What we did in the book was to identify some key storylines about carbon capture and storage. So this is, I would say, the dominant, and I think it's still the dominant storyline, that we need to encourage all technologies. We are heavily dependent on fossil fuels. About 80% of the energy consumption globally is still fossil fuels. And CCS allows us, in a way, to burn more fossil fuels. And we need governmental support, and we need other measures to get there. Okay, the enthusiastic CCS proponents, they are more like, this is the solution for most things. It's the critical pathway to shift the world economy onto low carbon emission pathway. And it's related to all the cost we've invested in this fossil fuel system. It's like a big tanker that is going to turn around in a few seconds, and that's not really that likely. And this is the story I think the oil and gas companies often use, that the fossil fuels will remain the foundation of the global energy supplies for much of the coming century. I think this is where you have the huge debate and controversy in different scenarios and between different actors in society, between the people who argue for a renewable energy future with much less fossil fuels, and this story, which is usually the one that the International Energy Agency advocates. Okay, then you have the more reluctant CCS advocates, and I'm one of them. It's not without problems and shortcomings, and there are some priorities that should be followed, in my view. You should have energy efficiency, new renewables, and other low carbon options, maybe as the first priority. And it's necessary for other reasons also to engage other sectors fully. And that's one of the purposes of the Northern Light project. Okay, then the critical storylines, because in many countries like Germany, there are huge resistance towards CCS, and especially underground storage under cities and villages and so on. And they basically, I think there's a connection to nuclear in Germany, where this is seen as an end of pipe solution. It's expensive, it's risky, it will come too late, and it competes with renewables. So in my view, what they never managed in the beginning, early days of CCS, was to align CCS with the renewable energy story in Europe, in the European Union, and so on. And that's why I think it failed in political terms. Okay, so love it or hate it. Some hate it, like Greenpeace and others. There are still reasons that we need CCS. And the 1.5 report actually puts that point to the forefront. We need zero emissions. And CCS can, to some extent, get us to zero emissions. We need to remove carbon from the atmosphere in the later part of this century. So we need negative emissions, and we therefore need CCS. And CCS might in some circumstances be the most cheapest and less costly option. Okay, so then to industrial CCS, because one of the changes from 2009 and today is that the focus has shifted from thermal electricity production to industrial CCS. I think that is a good thing, because it's much easier to align with a renewable energy future. That's one thing. The other thing is that it doesn't compete, and it provides an opportunity where there are fewer options to do anything about greenhouse gas emissions. But I would be careful with the utilization part. Because the U, if it's just delaying emissions and not storing emissions, it will lead into the same problems that one experienced with CCS on thermal power plants, in my view. So I think it's necessary to be cautious about that. So the Northern Light projects, which will be explained afterwards, I think is a very good project. Industrial CCS really makes sense because it provides options for industries who cannot or haven't got other options to reduce their emissions. So this is the two potential industrial projects in Norway that will kind of capture CO2, transport and store it in the North Sea. So my conclusion is that we need to speed up CCS. And in Norway, we need a positive investment decision for a full-scale industrial CCS chain in next year or 2021. And there's a but. We need much more than CCS. We need lifestyle changes, investments in renewables, reductions in fossil fuel consumption, reductions in energy consumption, changes in transport, agriculture, food. Every other sector has to be part of the transition. That's my main message.